Ladies and gentlemen, let me call this meeting to order. Start our recorder. Okay, ladies and gentlemen, this is the September meeting for the Valdosta County Zoning Board of Appeals. Let me explain how we operate so you can keep up with us and understand as we proceed. I will call each case by case number and case name. Staff will come to the lectern and present the request. After they have presented the request, there will probably be questions or discussions among board members to staff. Once we have heard from staff and we think we understand, then I will ask if there is anyone here in support or if the applicant is here or someone representing the applicant and would like to give us any additional information. Please come to the lectern and give us the information. Again, there is probably going to be discussions, questions, back and forth. Once we are satisfied, we have heard that side of the case, then I will ask if there are any persons here in opposition. If there are multiple people in opposition or multiple people that may have questions about what is being requested, please, one person come to the lectern, give us your name and address for the record. Please give us the information you would like for us to take under advisement. Once you have presented your information, there is possibly going to be discussions or questions among board members or to the person. If there are multiple people here in opposition, we would like to know that you are here. We may have everybody stand up or something. If your opposition or your question has already been presented to us, please don't come up and hit us four or five times with the same information. Once we've heard it, we will have heard it. If you feel like information has not been brought to our attention that you think is pertinent, please come to the lectern, give us your name and address for the record, and give us that information. We do have a lengthy agenda. It could run late, so we would like to try to move on if we can. Also, please give us all the information that you would like us to take under advisement, if possible, so that we don't end up with rebuttal and re-rebuttal back and forth. We'd like to get it all the first time around, if possible. Okay, first case we're going to call is Lowndes County case VAR 2016-14, Letitia Baker, 3941 Fender Road, Valdosta, Georgia. Carmella, you have our attention.
Good afternoon, everyone. My first case this afternoon is a variance request by Ms. Letitia Baker. Letitia is moving, is relocating to Georgia from Arkansas, and on the way here, they broke down, so she couldn't make the meeting. So she asked that we go ahead along with the variance request. But this is a variance request to our design standards for single-family homes. The property is located on Fender Road and consists of about 15 and a half acres. Such property is zoned R1, and within the R1 zoning, we have design standards for all of our zoning districts. And if you pay attention to the table that's in the staff report, within the R1, your house design has to be at least 21 feet wide, roof pitch has to be 312, so on and so forth. She's proposing to put a single-wide manufactured home where there once was a double-wide, which was destroyed by fire. It was an arson. And she's requesting to be allowed to put a single-wide mobile home on the property to live in. They're relocating back to Lowndes County. She states financial hardship as one of the causes. As you can see from the zoning map, the property or the zoning that's on the south side of Fender Road is RA zoning, which is residential agriculture. That zoning will allow single-wise, double-wise, site-built homes, so that's why we have a mixture of housing types along Fender Road. With that, staff is recommending approval. We feel that the proposed home will land very well in this area and not be outscale with what's already going on. So with that, we're recommending approval.
And I'm going to assume this is a picture of the mobile home that they have already brought in.
That is correct.
Okay.
She's first.
And when I went and looked, it appeared to me at least that it's probably going to be set up where this one is. They're not planning on moving that, I'm assuming. And it is back up in there.
Yes, halfway business property, yes, sir.
Any questions, any discussions from the board at this time? Thank you, Carmella. Being that Ms. Baker is not here, is there anyone here that would like to speak on her behalf or in support of this request? Is there anyone here that has questions or is opposed to this request? Was there any contact in your office, Carmella?
No, sir, no.
Any other discussions from the board, ladies and gentlemen? And I entertain a request, a motion, I'm sorry.
I have a motion to approve.
I have a motion from Mr. Alvarado.
As presented, citing criteria D.
As presented, citing criteria D. Do I have a second?
Second.
I have a second, Mr. McCall. All in favor, please raise a hand. Unanimous. Okay, the next case is VAR 2016-15, Tyler Hamby, 7235 Alvey Road, Valdosta, Georgia. Carmella?
Yes, sir. This is a request for variance to our minimum lot width requirements. The property consists of about 6.5 acres and is located off of Alvey Road. The DOC requires that within the EA zoning that you have a lot width of 210 feet. And in this case, Mr. Tyler wishes to construct a home. However, if you look at the map there, his 210 feet lot width doesn't occur until we're about in excess of 400 feet from the right of way. He would like to construct a home that is comparative and in continuity with existing homes that's located to the north of the property. This home will be about, say, approximately about 100 feet from the right-of-way. It will be in line with other homes in that area. So with that, staff felt he's not doing anything that's out of scale with what's already going on, and we are recommending approval of this request.
Any questions?
I have a question. How did these lots get made? I mean, how did these crazy-shaped lots that are too narrow get made?
Well, as long as you meet the minimum lot area, lot width requirement, this was once a family farm, and...
Okay, well, what if he's not meeting the lot width requirement?
It meets it, but it's 400 feet back. That's where his lot will, is 210 feet.
And so it doesn't have to be at the road?
At the road, 60.
60,
60
at the road.
At the road.
So you can have flag lots.
Yes.
So flag lots in reverse.
Yeah.
Okay.
Any other questions, discussions from the board? Thank you, Carmella. Is Mr. Hamby here? Well, would you like to speak, or is there anyone here who would like to speak?
I'm here. I think Ms. Carmella covered it pretty well.
Is there anyone else in support that would like to? Can I get your name and address for the record?
Yeah, Nathan Smith, 3890 Island Creek Road. I'm with the Hernan Company. I'm also here representing the sellers, too, of the property. My understanding that, you know, when it was first platted out, that it was inside of the law, 200 feet, and then they moved it to 210. That's what I understand. He just wants to do this house in line with all the other houses that are out there. So,
all right.
Just here to answer any questions.
Any questions, any discussion from the board? Thank you.
Thank you.
Is anyone else would like to speak on behalf of Mr. Hamby? Is there anyone here in opposition, or does anyone have a question about what Mr. Hamby has requested? Is there any contact to your office, Carmella?
No, sir.
Ladies and gentlemen, any other questions, discussions before I ask for a question? Can I get a motion on this request?
I make a motion that we approve site criteria D.
I have a motion from Mr. McCall to grant the request as presented, site criteria D. I have a second from Mr. Alvarado. All in favor, please raise your hand. Unanimous. Good luck with it, Mr. Hammond. Okay, the next case we'll call is VAR 2016-17, Union Springs Subdivision LLC, Union Road, Hay Hira.
Yes, sir.
And before you start, I have a question. What happened to 60?
They with kind of withdrew. It's coming.
Okay.
Later.
I was concerned that somehow we had lost something in translation. Yes, ma'am, Carmella.
All right, the county's last request before you is a variance, actually two variance requests by Union Springs Subdivision. Subject property is located off of Union Road in the unincorporated area of Niles County, but within our zip code. The board may recall this request a couple of months ago, whereas they are developing a conservation subdivision. And within the standards of a conservation subdivision, there are certain guidelines you have to meet. I believe the board granted them a variance to the sanitary sewer requirement that was in one of the standards back in June, but they're back. There are two additional standards that they are requesting for relief from. The first variance is to the designation of their wetlands. As you can see, I think I put before you a larger, yes, site plan, plot layout. If you pay particularly attention to the red lines, which follows the wetlands delineation lines, one of the standards for conservation subdivisions that any wetlands, one of the flood plain areas, groundwater recharge has to be contained within an open space. And as you can see from the southern portion of the lot layout, their open space consists of about 50 some odd acres. But some of the wetlands kind of lead into some of the individual lots that they're trying to sell. And as per the conservation subdivision standards, you can't, none of the wetlands can be on any privately owned lots. So they're requesting a variance to that particular standard. There's about six lots where you can see where the wetlands kind of blend in. But if you add all of those areas up, it totals less than an acre. I think it's like 7/10 of an acre, and the design question is here. They can explain that to you. The second variance is to, if you look at the cul-de-sac, there are two larger lots, lots 15 and lot 16, that do not meet our minimum lot frontage requirement. In a conservation subdivision, you're required to have a minimum 80-foot lot frontage. They're proposing 60. So they're requesting a variance to that particular standard. Staff is of the opinion that developers intentionally tried to make an effort to contain most of the wetlands in their open space. And with that, we're in support of what they're proposing at this point. We had somewhat of a debate, staff did, with the way the lots were drawn. You know, why couldn't he follow the wetlands line and just have a jagged, you know, property line, but it was the developer's desire to have just straight lines for Mark Building for them. So with that, we were in favor of both variance requests and support it. And the design direction was here if you have any specific questions.
First question I'd like to ask, what is the county's position where the road is going through the wetlands that's supposed to be delineated? How does that affect us?
I will need some help by their engineer with that, if you don't mind.
Okay.
Is the plain road?
Before we answer that, is there any other questions, any discussion from the board for Carmella, or she'll still be available?
I have one question about the cul-de-sac lots.
Yes, ma'am.
Were it not for the wetlands just being on the back, would 60-foot have met the minimum requirement for the road frontage?
No, they still needed 80.
So the 20-foot had variance that they're requesting for lot has nothing to do with the wetlands. It's just that they're requesting that for lot.
That's correct. We even offered, you know, maybe he shift that off around. He may lose a lot or two if he shift it back. But that was part of our conversation with him, just moving some lot line.
Well, and so you have the red line drawn here at the where the 80-foot is. Why can't they make that 80-foot, make the circle a little bigger, and those lots become fractionally smaller? There, one of them is more than 2 acres anyway.
Yeah, they're pretty large. There's a way. You know, it's just their preference.
That's not hardship. Okay, I have a question about the wetlands on the properties. We're not going to find that the property owners who buy these properties who are backed up to this nice wetlands all of a sudden are finding that they have, you know, a lake in the backyard on, you know, 100-year flood. Maybe they wish they hadn't bought wetlands in their yard.
I'm sure the survey that they have will depict those wetlands. I mean, they'll know that.
But we could be helping to protect them by not putting it on their property, right? By saying it has to be in the conservation area rather than letting it be on somebody's private property. Say it's wetlands.
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
That is an option. Any other questions?
I got one question. Can these wetland areas within the lots be built upon?
No, they would have to meet Army Corps of Engineer standards. If it's done a certain way, as long as they get a permit from the Army Corps, it's a possibility, but chances are they won't be able to do that. Without having an engineer involved.
Specifically on lot 35 and 36, where it appears that the wetland area crosses the road, how would they put a driveway on those lots? Could you put a driveway over the wetland area?
I'm not sure, but he's here, the design person is here to answer that. And we had some talk with them about just reconfiguring the layout to go around those wetlands, but I'm sure they have a response to that. They prefer to do it this way.
Okay, any other questions or discussions? Yes, sir. Your turn. Name and address for the record, please.
For the record, my name is Clayton Milligan. I'm at 3998 Inner Perimeter Road, Philadelphia, Georgia. I'm with LEA Level Engineering, representing the client, which is Union Springs LLC. Carmel did a good job summarizing kind of where we're coming from. Just briefly, this is the first conservation subdivision that's come through since the ULDC was put in place in 2006. So we've been working closely with them. This is the first kind of real test of how did these regs actually apply to, you know, a subdivision that's coming through. I'll address the cul-de-sac first, if that's okay. Every other, and Carmel, you correct me if I'm wrong, as the previous case she mentioned, but 60-foot road frontage is what every other zoning category requires, I believe. And so for some reason, when the conservation, when that portion of the code was written, it's got an 80-foot road frontage. That's not a lot width. We still meet all the lot width requirements because of the bigger cul-de-sac lots. But this is just the road frontage requirement that we're requesting a variance on. And we could, as was mentioned, put a jog in the right-of-way and follow the red line that you're looking at with that right-of-way to make it work. It's just, we felt like from a continuity standpoint down the road that it would just follow the conventional size cul-de-sac that we always do everywhere else and keep the right-of-way smaller. And go where we're showing the yellow lines on the exhibit that you're looking at.
14, what's the road frontage on 14?
We've adjusted lots, we adjusted lot 14, so it has 8 foot.
So 14 and 17 have 8 foot, and mm-hmm. 16 and 15 don't, and that circle isn't big enough for all four of them to have 8 feet.
We made everything work, and that's what 15 and 16 is what we kind of we got to the end and couldn't get the 80-foot lot frontage. We have to bump the...
So you'd have to make the circle totally bigger, and everybody's... Those lots are...
And those are, I guess that was one of my, those are some of the bigger lots, so we're not asking for smaller lots. We're not trying to squeeze more lots into the
Right, well, those aren't some of the bigger lots, so they could... could make the circle bigger.
Yes, we could, the right-of-way line could follow the red line that you're looking at, and we just didn't, from a... surveying platting standpoint, it's going to look odd, but it would work.
I have a question.
Yes.
Carmel, why in the ULDC, if all other zoning districts have 60-foot road frontage, does this one have 80?
It's just a recommendation from the consultant to do it this way, because a conservation subdivision, the idea is to cluster your lots so you have smaller lots and not bigger lots. And
right, so the smaller road frontage would make sense. 60 rather than 80 for clustering the lots.
Right, you're right. This is something
So this is the first one?
Yes.
Okay.
So that was kind of our thinking as well. Like, you'd think it would be smaller. I don't know if it was the typo when it was originally put through or where that 8 foot came from.
I apologize. I needed to clarify. I thought that's the question that I was asking about the cul-de-sac was, if it were not for the wetlands, would 60 feet meet the road frontage? And I thought you said no, it would not, but it would, were it not for the...
No. If it's not in the conservation, 60 would be fine. Because they are requesting conservation, it triggered 80.
Okay. So it's not the wetlands, it's the conservation that's triggering.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Okay.
Can we talk about the
count? The road that is going through.
Yes.
Explain that to us.
The road that's going through the wetlands, we've gotten what we call a jurisdictional determination from the Army Corps of Engineers. And so the line that, I don't know if you can see it on here, but the tan-colored line that goes through there, and then it's red where it approaches on the glass. That's the actual field-delineated wetland line, I think. The slide that's up here on the screen, the dashed area, is what we call the National Wetlands Inventory Line. So that's kind of a bird's-eye GIS map where they think the wetlands are. We actually went in, this is field-delineated, Army Corps of Engineers approved. They said, yes, we agree, this is where the line is. So, what you're looking at on your...
That orange line.
The orange line, yes. Is the actual... Now, I changed the red where it's encroaching on the lots. Just for clarity. But where it's not encroaching on lots, it's orange. It has that orange wetland hatch behind it.
All right. Well, so in the middle of, south of the road, in what's not a lot, but in the conservation area, the orange line sort of comes down into a... use,
mm-hmm.
and then it comes back up,
mm-hmm.
and then the lot line goes straight, and the wetlands on the red comes into the back of lot number 56.
Right.
So that part that's next to 56, that road part, that's not in the wetlands. Just that little bit that's by lots 33 and 36 of the road is in the wetlands.
Yes, and the portion of the road that went through the wetland, we're actually disturbing less than a tenth of an acre of wetland, which falls within the Army Corps requirements of we don't have to pay mitigation, we just have to document to the Corps that we're disturbing less than a tenth of an acre. So there's actually an old spoil pile in the middle there that the Army Corps did not count as a wetland. There's this big pile of dirt right where our road went through, so we aligned our road right with that dirt to minimize the impact to the wetland area surrounding it, and that where you see the red line where it's squared off, there on lots 35 and 36, that's an old irrigation pit that was dug years ago, but the way the rules are written, it's got standing water in it now, so it falls under Army Corps of jurisdiction, so they claim.
So it's going to be in somebody's front yard?
So there's that, where the red line is shown, yes, between lots 35 and 36, that's a jurisdictional wetland.
That's their personal choice to buy the lot or buy the one.
And so, well, from our perspective, we can draw the lot lines directly on the red line that you're looking at. We can make the lot lines follow the wetland line. It's a field delineated line. If somebody went out there 5 years from now and redelineated the wetland, it's probably going to change, you know, 2-3 foot, maybe 1 meter. The wetland line's not a hard concrete line in the sand, so to speak. It fluctuates. But this is, the Army Corps jurisdiction is good for 5 years, so that's what we develop off of when we get a jurisdiction. But from a development standpoint, we would like, in a surveying standpoint, a plat standpoint, we like straight lines, and we felt you're well within the spirit of what was trying to be accomplished is, okay, because before we worked with the county, we had lots 43 and 56 there actually touched. We just had one lot line in the middle, in between lots 43 and 56. So we've actually revised our plat. We put a gap in there. We moved them, you know, moved it out and pretty much kind of took an average and ran our straight line as close to that, you know, the delineated wetland line as we could. And rather than have between lots 35 and 36 this odd little box left over of open space, just go ahead and rectangular lots for 35 and 36. So whether they owned it or not, it's still going to be in their front yard.
Can we go back to that question that we asked? Can they cut down whatever in that little wetland area and put a shed or their driveway or accessory?
You cannot, and that's, you cannot, per Army Corps, this is Army Corps jurisdiction, so you cannot disturb the ground at all within a wetland. So you can't.
So where are they going to put the driveways on lots 30?
These are
35 and 36.
You'd almost have to, and I'm speaking out of turn, you'd almost have to have a driveway between 34 and 35 right up the line.
Well, keep in mind, these lots are 168 feet wide. Lot 35 is 168 feet wide. Lot 36 is 165 feet wide. So the wetland goes about half a lot. So I've still got 80 feet of non-wetland road frontage that we can put a driveway to get to the house. On lots 35 and 36.
Okay, imagine that I'm not the original homeowner who buys lot number 35, who knows that I got wetlands in my front yard and I'm not supposed to do anything. Imagine that I'm buyer number 2 or 3 down the line. And I go, oh, you know, these trees in the front yard, I don't want to go for them. Come down. I mean, what's to prevent this from happening in the future? I mean, covenants and blah, blah, blah.
Right.
You know, if you go 2 or 3 owners in, and people don't pay attention to that.
Right. I mean, my answer to that question is no different than, you know, any wetland anywhere else in the county. It's protected by Army Corps, whether somebody goes in there and, you know, disturbs that wetland. There's existing provisions in there. If they're caught, there's consequences from Army Corps.
So, and based on history that I am aware of in other areas, it's pretty much complaint driven.
Right.
You know, if somebody does something in there and nobody says anything, no harm, no foul.
Right.
But as soon as somebody raises a red flag and says something, then somebody's got to answer, and that person is going to be the second or the third owner, and they're going to say, well, I didn't know. And at that point, they're going to say, well, but you got to fix it.
We've been involved in several cases in Mounds County where our courts come in and, you know, trees have been cut down, but a homeowner has been required to plant back, do mitigation plans, plant stuff back, and it's costly.
This delineation, you said it's only locked in for 5 years. So it could be drier 5 years from now, and they could hire a surveyor to come in and have their front of their yard redelineated to say it is no longer in wetlands, and then they're free to do whatever they want.
Or it could potentially go the other direction, too. So
right.
We could have more of your yard wet. I mean,
So is that all an irrigation ditch? Is that why it's shaped like that? Has that square shape?
That's why it has that square shape.
And that's, but that's considered wetland, even though it's man-made?
Yes.
If it's got standing water in it, they gonna plumb it.
If I design it, I've had situations here in Lowndes County where I've designed a detention pond, a full-on fenced-in detention pond, and 5 years later, it's a wetland. It's a jurisdictional wetland. We can't even go in there and modify the detention pond. I'd be happy if y'all would call your congressman.
Does the provision for a tenth of an acre to be developed? Just with the letter to the Corps of Engineers, does that provision apply to the homeowner?
No, they look at a development as a whole. So our letter goes on record. Let's say somebody buys lot 36 and says, "Hey, I'm only going to disturb, you know, a tenth of an acre." They have a GIS based record, so they know what area they've already approved stuff, and they'll go in and say, "No, nope, we've already approved up, you know, a tenth of an acre's already been used up," for lack of a better term.
Outside of this ordinance designation for conservation easement, it is not uncommon to have property lines extend into and across wetlands and or state waters or other conservation areas like that, correct?
That is correct. This is specific to the conservation subdivision regulations. Otherwise, I mean, lot lines can cross wetlands, state waters, any of those features in any of the other zoning designations.
If approved, how would you address this wetland from an engineering standpoint? Will there have to be a culvert crossing the road right there?
We have a double, I believe it's a double 24-inch culvert design at that wetland crossing right there. Because even if there wasn't a wetland there, that's a natural low point for where that field comes. And so we've got drainage coming through there, and we've designed the pipes to adequately convey that stormwater underneath the road, not over the road.
Any other questions? Any other discussions?
I wanted to, you brought up a question earlier about flooding, mm-hmm. potential flooding. This is outside the conservation subdivision, but Lowndes County has requirements in place that we have to establish a finished floor elevation that's 2 feet above the 100-year high water mark on any lot, whether it's in the conservation subdivision or elsewhere. So on our plat, the final plat, we'll have on lots that are adjacent to a wetland, we actually have to put on the plat finished floor elevation and actually get a specific elevation so when the builders go to build, they know the finished floor has got to be certain
elevation. So when
the
lake comes up around
these people's houses,
it's not going to fully right. So there's, Mount County has provisions in place to address that. Any other questions? Any other discussion? Thank you, sir. Did anyone else here in support of this application or anyone have the information they'd like to give us concerning this? Is anyone here in opposition to this request or has questions about what is being requested?
My name is John Pike. I live at 61 Frank Paul Road. We have a 1,200-foot property line that we share. I've been there 28 years. Spoke about this at the beginning to make a request of rezoning. Mentioned the concerns that we had as far as the traffic and drainage, set tanks installed, wildlife, taxes increased, and polluted water runoff. And none of these things seemed to bother anybody when they were considering these things. The developer himself is aware of everything that's on that plat. When he made it out, he presented it. He knew what a conservation subdivision required. He made that plat according to it. Now he was going to change everything. The roads are already in. I don't think the gentleman made that clear. These roads aren't going to be put in. They're in. They're paved. So they take it upon themselves to go ahead and do these things. I reckon they understood that y'all were going to approve them.
Now, understand that other than these couple of variances, they can do what they want to do as far as putting this in by right, by code.
Okay.
The only thing they'd have to do is they would have to redesign a couple of these lots to avoid these couple of small spots. Otherwise, they wouldn't have to come before this board at all.
They knew that when they made these properties, like you suggested earlier, they knew these things. They knew it was a 60-foot frontage. They knew it was an 80-foot required. This conservation subdivision, they knew that when they went and did all these drawings.
Yes, sir.
That's right. And they just took it upon themselves to go ahead and do it, and then come back and ask for a variance.
Yep. Yes, sir. Okay. You have two lots out of the entire bunch that doesn't meet code. If we deny this, if we just say you can't, you don't get either one of the variances that you're asking for, that doesn't kill it. All they got to do is go back and redraw a couple of lot lines, and they can do this without asking anybody.
Yes, sir. I'm quite aware. I am not going to kill this subdivision. I understand that very much so. But I'd like to mention a couple things here also. I got on the EPA website, okay, and I looked at wetlands. And it, this is quoted from their website. The basic premise of the program is that no discharge of dredge or fill material be permitted if a practical alternative exists that is less damaging to the aquatic environment, the nation's waters would be significantly degraded. Also, it's also stated there that when you apply for a permit, you should show that you have, to the extent practical, that you've taken steps to avoid the impact on the wetlands, that you've minimized potential impact on the wetlands, and that you provided compensation. Okay? Like, again, these people knew these things, the roads are in. I just like to suggest that if you go along and start making changes now, after they've already done things, what are we going to continue to approve these people to do? Especially after they've already taken upon themselves to do it, without coming before you and asking these things.
Well, at this point, like I said, they have been in discussion with staff. The couple of infringements that they have asked for, and I know you're wrong, I'm not saying it will be granted. I'm just saying, if this board says no to both variances, all they're going to do is redraw a couple of lots, and then they can do it by right.
Okay. Well, I suggest that you make them do that instead of just granting variances, because that's all
I understand.
They're going to come put it here, like I say. If they know ahead of time, they're going to come up here and get everything they want, and I suggest instead of me taking time off from work to come up here and argue pointlessly, I suggest you just go ahead and give them everything they want today where they don't have to come back up here and ask for another thing.
I understand. I hear what you're saying, sir, and at the same time, this board does not always grant everything that people ask for.
One thing, I just found out I wasn't invited to the request about the septic tanks, and I'm a property owner there. I didn't get that letter. Okay.
That is the health department, sir.
Okay, I'm just saying, the septic tanks have not even been approved for these lots.
And if
I live there, I know how wet it is.
If the septic tanks are not allowed, if they will not perk, according to health department regs, they will not grant a building permit for that lot. That is health department regs, that's not us. Is anyone else here in opposition or has questions about what is being requested?
Can you say something, baby?
Yes, ma'am. Can I get your name and address for the record?
Becky Parr, 6208 Guinea Road, New York, Georgia.
Yes, ma'am.
Where are the other property owners beside it? And I do know that this land has run off. So the wetlands is on my property, too.
Yes, ma'am.
So, I mean, they've already paid through the wetlands right here. It's already paid in.
They have a statement from the Corps of Engineers allowing them to do that.
But why were they already paid? Why was the road already paid before? They just paid it.
They already had the agreement from the Corps of Engineers for the road.
But my question is, before the meeting, why was the road paid and this was supposed to be approved from y'all?
The road is not being approved for us.
But it's part of the wetlands, correct?
The county part of the road is county, and that was approved by the Corps of Engineers for them to put that piece of road across there. We don't have any, that's not our responsibility.
But shouldn't it already, if y'all were doing the variance, shouldn't the road been on hold until y'all approved it?
It's not required.
It's not required. And septic tanks are not required until later?
Until the health department comes out and looks at it, then they...
So when are we going to get that approved? I mean, because...
Before they can build on any lot.
But my question is, I have three landscaping trees. My question is, if I know that this property floods, it floods my property, my trailer sinks, I have to hire somebody to lift it up every 2 or 3 years. If this property, I have lot 1 through 14, I'll be looking at least 1 through 8. Why not get the septic tank approved and have all your approvals before you go ahead and approve all this?
I can't answer that question as far as why it's set up that way. Normally, they don't. The health department does not come out and approve the septic tank until they start pulling a permit to build on that lot.
But wouldn't it make more sense if y'all had all the approvals first?
Ma'am, I'm not arguing that point. I tend to agree with you. But that's just the way that it is set up in Lowndes County, and I don't know about any other counties, but the way it's set up, the health department does not come out to determine where you can put a well, where you can put a septic tank, and where you can put a house until they have plans and until they start looking at this is what we're going to do on this lot.
Okay. Because I see it, probably half of them on my property is probably not going to park unless they're going to do a front fence tank, and that's all they're doing.
Well, that does not fall in this board's jurisdiction. That's county, that's the county commissioners, the health department, the engineer.
Are you going to have another meeting on that?
This board does not meet with them on these things. We deal only with the variances once they figure out this is what we want to do, and the county says you can do this, you can do that, you can do the other, you can't do this, you can't do that without a variance, or you can't do this at all because there's no condition for a variance.
Well, to me, I've lived out there my whole life. It would make sense if they get...
I understand exactly what you're saying. It's just that's not the way it's done in Lowndes County, and this is the first one of these that we've done. It is possible, maybe probable, that once they start talking about some of the things they've encountered here, some of the rules may change.
What about the traffic and the turn lanes?
If they meet the requirements without any request for a variance, if they redesign the lots slightly or even do without one or two or three lots to avoid the wetlands in the conservation, they can do this without asking for any variance. That's what I was saying, is they can do this.
I know they're doing it. I hear them 6 o'clock to 7 o'clock.
They can do it by right. And if we turn both of these variances down, that does not stop this.
I understand that. But I mean, why not ask for the perk test and the lots? I mean, that would give them the lot size and where they put the lots. To me, that makes sense.
I understand what you're saying. It's just not the way it's done in Lowndes County right now. It might change in the future, but it's not the way it's done right now. Is there anyone else here in opposition? Okay. Eric, I have a question.
Eric, how much of the wetlands total acreage is being requested as a variance? Remind us.
I believe it was 7/10 of an acre total would fall, end up falling within a platted lot.
All of those lots in total, 7/10 of an acre?
Yes.
And Carmella, correct me if I'm wrong with the statements that I just made. If this board says no, all they got to do is get Lovell to go in there and redraw the lines, and they can still do this.
That's correct.
Okay. You want to make sure I wasn't off base when I said that. Eric, you had something else to add?
I was just going to briefly address this, the septic issue since it came up, but that's, I didn't know.
Well, I will hear.
We have already done a, and this is the responsibility of the developer. So anywhere in Lowndes County, you can take a risk and plat your lots without looking at the soils, but the health department's going to come out there, and if they don't perk, you're not going to build a house on that lot. We have taken the extra step. We've already done another 4 soil surveys. The health department has already been out there, has looked at all of these lots. So we did our homework beforehand to make sure we weren't going to run into that issue ahead of time. So we have been addressing that, but it's not required. It's not a county requirement.
Okay, so in effect, the developer and the health department and Lovell Engineering have discussed this, even though they don't have permits for each and every lot from the health department. It is the opinion of the health department that they are confident that at least most of them, if not all of them, will be conditions to make it a saleable lot.
That would be an accurate statement. They are still going to go out there, and the health department, my thing, they're going to drill 4 holes on every lot and tell you exactly where your drain field can go and if it's going to work.
Okay.
Just to clarify, because of some of the statements that were made earlier, the United States Corps of Engineers did receive the application for changes to the wetlands prior to the road going in, and they approved it prior to the road going in.
Yes, the county will not approve a set of construction drawings without that.
And that approval from the Corps of Engineers was in hand?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
Thank you.
Okay, any other questions, any other discussions? Was there any response to your office, Carmella, on this?
Yes, sir. I did get not only a call from Mr. Pike and Ms. Becky, but I did get a call from another adjoining property owner in opposition to the request.
Okay. Any other discussions, any other questions? Does everybody think they understand the pros and cons and the ramifications of what we've talked about and the options that you have? Basically, you can accept it as is. You can accept one without the other. You can deny it totally. You can modify it. It's a wide open slate for the board. So when someone makes a motion, please make it very specific as to what we're voting on. One more question, Ms. Corbin.
In a conservation subdivision, how much of the property total must be in conservation?
At least 40%, and they've exceeded.
They've exceeded, yes.
Do we know about how much they exceeded?
About 46% in conservation.
Any other questions before I call the question? Any discussion? Can I get a motion on this request? And your motion needs to specify both of the items in question, the minimum front footage on lots 15 and 16, and the designation of the open space, which is included in a couple of lots, or four or five lots.
Can we do them separately, or do you want to do them?
Well, in the past, we've usually done them combined, because it is one case with one request with two variances. However, you can make the motion any way you wish.
Well, that minimum road frontage, I think that we need to change the ULDC. I think we need to change the ULDC so that it's in conformity with all of the rest of the road frontage that we require for every other lot. So if all the rest of the lots say 60, then this section should say 60. So I want to make a motion to approve that they can be 60 with the note to staff that we should, I mean, that's how we find things are wrong in the ULDC, is they come and then we go, well, yeah, that doesn't work.
Especially the intent of the conservation subdivision is to cluster. That makes no sense to have a larger road frontage requirement in the cul-de-sac.
Can I please ask one thing real quick?
Please, you're out of order.
So I would make a motion to approve the minimum road frontage at 60, and then staff look to make it in conformance.
Okay, we have a motion on the floor. Ms. Quarterman, grant the variance for the minimum road frontage on lots 15 and 16 at 60 feet. And that is subject to criteria D. I have second. All in. No, we already have second. Ms. Plyler gave us a second. Okay, all in favor of this motion, please raise a hand and hold it. Okay, unanimous, 6-0. All right, we still have to deal with the variance number one designation of open space, and I get a motion on that part of this request. In this case, in the lack of a motion, I assume that we have a no situation.
Further discussion?
Is there any further discussion to resolve this issue? Because without a motion, in essence, it is a deny.
I guess just in kind of throwing things out, maybe to help us talk about, there's not a lot of land per lot that is being affected. To me, the most egregious is lots 35 and 36, because they're in the front. And Mr. Strickland is correct that people can choose whether or not to purchase that lot or not, or go on the way. But I think that Ms. Portman is also correct that most people are not going to know what they can do with wetlands or not. And part of our job is to protect our citizens. Redrawing, those would be some funky lots on 35 and 36. The rest of them aren't bad, and Eric, you can correct me if I'm wrong, but there doesn't look like, they're all over acre lots. It would just be a little odd shaped in the back of the lots, but they would still look like they would all be able to have a minimum of an acre. And then, you know, the realtor side of me says, with this, in having wetlands, they're going to struggle to get a mortgage, or they're going to have a flood insurance on it. So that, again, makes me want to protect them, since it is such a little amount to have those lots redrawn. I would rather see them being funky than to have the wetlands on. But again, it's so minimal, and it doesn't affect
I agree that 35 and 36 of the most egregious ones, to have that in the front yard is, it's not good.
Do you want to make a motion that that part is denied and that we withdraw?
And then they can come back to us?
No, if they withdraw.
If they withdraw, they won't have to.
If they withdraw, they just got to draw it so they come this, because that's the other side of this coin now. If we deny this, they can't bring it back for 1 year.
But they wouldn't have to bring it back.
They wouldn't have to bring it back if they redraw the lots to take the wetland out of the affected, the six lots or whatever it is. If they redraw those lines, then it doesn't matter. They don't have to come back before us in a year.
What's the minimum lot size?
For a conservation? No, for a conservation subdivision, they can go down to 10,000 square feet.
But then we have septic tank issues that there's minimum lots.
An acre is the minimum if they're going to have a septic tank.
Get a septic tank is enough.
So let's just look at lot number 41. If instead of drawing the on the yellow line that's there, if you draw along the red line and then just draw along that red line straight to the corner, not going to be too small there.
Eric, can you tell us whether or not any of these lots would be less than the
if this clarifies, if it helps, if the motion is denied, the red lines are going to be the lot lines, and we'll move forward with the red lines being the lot lines. And we'll just have a funky, jagged lot line. But if it's denied, the red lines are going to be the lot lines. If it's approved, the yellow line is going to be the lot line.
On lot 35 and 36, how much of the area, how big is the wetland area on each one of those lots?
We have, outside of the wetland, this is required by the septic regs and the well regs, we have to have an acre outside of the wetland. So if we draw the lot lines on the red lines, I still have 1+ acres on every lot.
So essentially the lot layout will remain exactly as it is.
Lot layout will change,
The line will just be the property line.
Right, the red line will be the property line instead of the yellow lines that we're showing.
Okay. So do we have a motion to deny? I'm just asking that.
Yes, I'll make a motion to deny variance request number one, designation of open space.
Okay, we have a motion on the floor to deny the number one variance, the designation of open space on the few existing lots that have wetlands on them. Do I have a second? I have second, Ms. Fowler. All in favor, raise your hand and hold it. All opposed? We have a tie. I get to vote. I will vote in support of the motion. Variance number one is denied, and they can redraw the lots and they'll be good to go. Okay. Thank you very much. Okay, moving on. The next case that we will hear is City Case Application 2016-05, Ray Connor, 2602 Lakewood Drive, Valdosta. Ms. Tracy, you have the floor.
Very close to the existing footprint, a little bit bigger, but very close to dimensionally
away from property lines where the old one was, which poses a problem now. Apparently, the older carport was permitted in about 1996, again, according to Lowndes County Key Public. Times change, regulations change. 2016 says an accessory structure such as a carport has to be at least 10 feet away from a side and a rear property line. From his rear property line, he's about 13 feet away from the property line. No problem there. From the side property line, he is on that particular property line. No deviation, no space from that particular property line. So he is asking for a 10-foot side yard variance for that particular property. Staff reviewed it, understand the situation. It's at the end of his driveway. It's very close in proximity to where the previous carport was. But again, regulations have changed over time. Staff reviewed it, did not find a hardship, and recommend for denial.
Okay, question.
If the old carport was there and came and asked to change, it would be a non-conforming structure.
Yes, ma'am.
And if he came and asked for a modification to a non-conforming structure, we would be, that would be what we would be looking at. The
defined modification part, so I understand your wonder.
Are
we talking about taking away the old one and putting the new one in, or are we talking about an addition to?
We're talking about he's going to make the one that he has there bigger.
If he were to make the existing one bigger, maybe an addition, maybe moving over, you know, a couple of holes one way or the other, he couldn't get any closer to the setbacks than he already was. In other words, 13 feet would have to stay, he couldn't be any closer than 10 feet, and he couldn't encroach any further on the setback than he already was. If that makes sense.
Okay, and does the current configuration, is it closer than it was?
Apparently it was.
You don't know because it's not.
Also keep in mind, all bets are off when he took away the old one.
It's not non-conforming anymore.
It's not non-conforming anymore. He had to move it.
How big was the old one? Was it a double?
20 by 16. The old one was 20 by 16.
As best we can tell, Lowndes County Key Public had it pegged at 20 foot by 16.
And what is this one?
It is 26 feet by 31 feet. You're looking at 806 square feet compared to what was about 320.
Okay. Any other questions before I make a couple of points?
Are there height requirements?
There are. An accessory structure can't be any taller than the primary structure. That is not an issue here. The proposed structure, well, the existing structure, is within a few inches of the house. It's, as best we can tell, it's not taller.
Okay. Clarification, or to make sure that we all understand it. The concrete slab is not the problem. The slab can be poured all the way up to the property.
Yes, sir.
You just can't have the building on it within 10 feet of the property.
It's the carport that's the issue. It's the
structure. We meet setback, or he meets setback in the back, so that's not a question. That's not a question.
13 feet versus 15.
If this board, and this may be the wrong time to put it out, but I'm going to put it out there anyway. If the board votes to deny the request, he still can go in there, modify what he has, and bring it off the property line 10 foot and 1 inch. And put it back up, and that would mean he would be parking the camper under the shed and parking the truck on the path.
Get his permit and move the structure over. That's what he's doing.
So, I'm just saying that is.
But
Doesn't make it go away, just makes it move 10 feet.
It doesn't make it any shorter. It's still gonna be that high, he can build it that high by right. He just is gonna have to move his post 10 foot from the property line, and then he meets code, he doesn't have to ask for anything. Okay, any other questions, any other discussions before we proceed? Anyone here would like to give me additional, or give the board additional information on this case?
Ready for me?
Yep. That's your cue, you come up and give us your two cents for it.
Good afternoon. Those of you all, my name is Brandon Connor, I live at 2602 Lakewood Drive. My wife and I sent in a, applied for this variance. What we're dealing with, folks, is we've been there for 27 years. This isn't something where we just moved in the neighborhood and we're trying to change the neighborhood. We've been there with great experience, that sort of stuff. What we're doing, we bought the RV with the intention to get ready for retirement. Making sure this is what we wanted to do, have a place to put it, that sort of stuff. We built it on top of the existing slab that was there, the two-car garage. Most of y'all know what I do for a living. I park my work car under it, and I've always driven a truck. Truck won't, or the work car won't fit in the garage. That's why I have that auxiliary facility. The addition went literally, and I've got a picture of it, it goes literally on the line where the previous slab was at. And like Tracy says, the rules have changed since then, where I didn't have to have it in the 90s, as far as having the slab there, but not for the hood.
Sure.
Anyway, this is a picture looking from the center of the road back at the RV and the slab. It shows that it was, the new slab is exactly on the property line, or on the driveway line as the previous one was. Before, there was a utility building in back of the slab and back of the two-car garage, and then there was a fence line. What I've done is taken down the utility building, moved away from the property line, and built the slab, and then built the cover on top of the slab. The problem we've run into, and I knew there was a slope there, but I didn't realize how much of a slope was. Not only have I got a slope going away from the house carports, I also have a slope going to the back of the property line. And there's a slight incline where we built the slab going onto it, right there where the carports are. At the back, it is 2 foot, almost 3 foot tall, 2 foot 8 inches tall. So it's a healthy slab, believe me. It's a lot more slab than I wanted to pay to buy, as far as that's concerned. We have built the bank, obviously. I thought I was in compliance, because compliance also says I have to be in the rear of the yard in order to have this type of vehicle parked at the house. So we built it in towards the backyard area of the house to be in compliance with that regulation. We approached both property owners, Dot, Ben, Barbara Hacker lives next door to me, Barbara's at work. I have a letter from her as far as the variance. She is the one that is directly affected by the variance. Barbara and I have always had a privacy fence between the two of us. I have agreed. She states in her letter she doesn't approve. She doesn't complain about the variance, and she doesn't complain about the slant or the building. And I've told her up front, I will build the property fence, the privacy fence back, just like it was. I'm waiting until I get all the paperwork in place before I spend any more money, is where we're at, as far as this is concerned. I'm going to build, put the privacy fence back in place. At this point, we've got to also, I realize I'm in compliance with the variance, but like I said, I'm trying to be the good neighbors as far as this is concerned, and make it to where there is a buffer. I offered to build this buffer
when I was talking to the Youngs and other folks, as far as a buffer on the rear side of it. I realize that there is a step-down gradient on the backside of the property. If you get in Doc's backyard, you've got a step down between the fence line and the pool, there's another step down between the pool and the back of the house, and there's another step down by the time you get to her front yard. There's a lot of step down, so it's standing above it. What I'd offer to do is come in and put cedar trees. There's a couple of different ones. There was even an article in the newspaper recently about the conservation guy said that these trees grow well in this area, and quoting him, it will go 20 to 40 foot to mature level. This trailer, or this cover, is listed as a 12-foot cover. I'll reel it, and that's at the bottom of the brace. The trailer is 13 and a half foot tall. So what I have to do is come over from the side of it, and it's at center point, it's just under, it's about 14 and a half foot tall. With the added 2.5 foot of slab, it gets it up there to 16, above 16 feet. I understand all that. That's the reason for saying that I plant the cedars as far as the back property line in order to create a buffer so that they won't see the back of my trailer, basically. And that sort of stuff. Got additional letters from the neighbor on the other side of me and also from one across the street. I missed one of them. Like me, has a job, it's hard to catch. The two of us. 2600 is one of the neighbors that's on the other side from the residence. He provided letters. One of the people that's going to be speaking in opposition is across the street. He's president of the homeowners association. So they're supporting Doc. I understand it is different for our neighborhood and that sort of stuff. I've got a copy of the report that was filed, and as such, I know some of the concerns that were raised by the neighbors and that sort of stuff. Drainage is one of the concerns. Drainage, this past storm that went through, wasn't any worse than it has been always, as far as it's concerned. There's a privacy fence along the back line, and actually the drainage is not going to go towards Dot and the neighbor behind her. It goes toward Barbara Hacker's house, as far as it goes to the north of us. Danger of wind. The windstorm we experienced with this last hurricane is about as bad as it's going to get usually around here unless you got a tornado. No damage, no structure damage to the cover as far as that's concerned. I don't know what else to say. I've got pictures that will show that you could barely see the RV from the street side in front of Doc Young's house. This is something that Cynthia and I are planning on doing. Except we're planning on having an RV. If we don't go from here, we'll deal with it as we need to. I got a question for y'all at the same time.
Okay.
If you don't approve it, and it's possible, I understand. If I come in and create that 10-foot variance to have the shelter there, that's all that's required, correct?
That was the point that I was making.
So I don't have to put a fence, I don't have to put a buffer, I don't have to do anything.
Because, and that's the point that I was trying to make sure that not only the board members remember that, but people in the audience, that what we are faced with is if you take the building down in its entirety, there's nothing that stops you from parking the RV there. It's still going to be the same RV. It's going to still be in the same place. It's just not going to have the roof over it. They're still going to see it. If you took it down in its entirety, then you don't have to put a privacy fence. You don't have to put up trees or vegetative buffering or anything like that.
What if I put a shelter 10 foot over?
That's the other point that I was making. the regulations say you cannot build within 10 feet of the property line. That doesn't mean your slab. The slab does not count as a building. If you measure over with a tape measure 10 feet and rebuild that side wall and shorten your roof line, then you met the intent of the regulations. You can still have a building that you could put your RV under. You would have to park your truck on the slab without a roof on it. That you can do by right. And that's, I just want everybody to understand that that is an option. It won't change the aesthetics. You'll still see the roof line. You'll still see the RV. But you will relieve it.
So there's no LDR provision that would prohibit the parking of an RV on that property?
No.
What about restrictive covenants of the subdivision? Is anybody that's allowed under that?
Okay, based on that, restrictive covenants is different than zoning regulations. Mm-hmm. Restrictive covenants, we don't have anything, we cannot grant a variance to a restrictive covenant. We can't do anything to that. That would be up to the homeowner association, and if the restrictive covenants are even still in effect, because restrictive covenants, and I may be preaching to the choir here, but they're good for 20 years.
That's what it says, expired.
And then they have to give 75%, isn't it 75% of the property owners to vote to reinstate those restrictions. And I don't have any idea whether they are in effect or not, but even if they are, that would be a case between them, the courts, and him. The Zoning Board of Appeals does not come into play. Hang on one second.
I was just going to answer your question.
Yes, sir?
There are no HOA regulations, and just as he's describing, they expired a long time ago and there are no new ones.
Okay, so at that point, you know, it wouldn't affect us anyway, but that's the way we have to operate.
To answer part of your question, I researched this. The only regulation that I thought that I needed to make because of the existing slab was there is a city ordinance for area as far as parking the RV in a considered a rear section of the property, and that's where the RV is being parked.
To kind of piggyback off of the discussion, he's referring to what we call the residential parking overlay. It requires that bigger vehicles, such as RVs, be parked either in the side yard or the rear yard, not in the front yard.
And side yard means from the back side of the house, not the front wall of the house, but the back wall of the house creates the side yard.
And that was where I was at, trying to cooperate or trying to meet the regulations as far as that's concerned, with it over the top of the existing slab.
Okay. Anything else, Richard? I mean, Raymond, I'm sorry.
Yes, sir.
Any questions, any discussions from the board for Mr. Tom?
Yes, I do have one question.
Yes, sir.
Whose house is this right here?
Todd Young's.
Okay. I just want to make sure you see it. Okay.
Okay, any other questions, any other discussion? Thank you, Raymond. Is there anyone else here in support of this application? And I understand why he's here, but is there anybody else in support other than the letter that we have? And the letter will be made part of the minutes if anybody needs to see them. And I need those back wherever they are. Is there anyone here in opposition to this request? And we know there is. I would ask that one person please come to the lectern at least to start, and then give us the information you'd like us to take under advisement, and then we will go from there to see if there's other people that have other things that they want to bring forth, as I said in the beginning of the meeting. Name and address for the record, please.
Yes, sir.
My name is George Camo, and I'm the current president of the Oldwood Valley Homeowners Association. And we wrote you a letter, which I assume you've read.
You can pack it.
Good.
Sir, can I have your address for the record?
Oh, I'm sorry, yes. I live at 2603 Lakewood Drive, right across the street from me.
Your house looks down his driveway, or you're one house down?
No, I'm directly across the street from him.
Okay.
And so I live a little bit down the driveway, but I'm not here to talk about my view.
Okay.
I'm here to tell you that the Homeowners Association Board opposes the RV cover. And our reasons are that we believe that the frame is too large and that it's an inappropriate structure for a neighborhood as ours. Plus, we also believe that the concrete pad is too large. Raymond talked about the dimensions, and it's nearly 3 feet high, and it exacerbates the imposing view of the structure because it raises it higher. You looked at a picture showing the view from the back from Dorothy Young, who's here. She sent you also a letter that has photographs. I won't go through that, but she probably want to make some comments about the view from that part of the street because of the general slope of the land going from where my house and Raymond's house are toward the river. In addition to the points that we made in our letters, there have been many, many neighbor complaints. Many have stopped across the street, in the road in front of Dot's house, looked up her driveway, and made very negative comments. One of the most common things that was said spontaneously by many people, and I think I cited this in my letter, we are becoming a trailer park. And that was said many, many times. I think our biggest concern, however, is the loss of land value. And we've had realtors examine it and have admitted that the land value will decrease. And I think we were hoping that in your review criteria, where you say that something shouldn't substantially diminish or impair property values, we think this does. And as such, we oppose it. Thank you.
All right. Anyone else would like to give us any additional information?
Can I just say?
Yes, ma'am.
I'm Dorothy Young. I live at 6673 North Sherwood Drive. I'm directly behind Raymond. I sent a letter and pictures because I had jury duty this week, but I wasn't seen. So I'm here, and I just want to make a couple of comments, and you've got the pictures and everything right there. The impact is the greatest on myself since I'm right behind Raymond. From inside my house, all of the windows on the back, when I go outside the back door, that's the only thing that you see is the big coat. It shows in the pictures that I gave you. The first one shows from my back. The second and third ones are taken from the windows on the back of my house. And the fourth one is looking at it from my street, North Sherwood Drive, straight up my driveway. I agree with what George has said, and I've had many residents stop, get their cameras out, take a picture, they come to my door, they've asked me about it. This subdivision has been there a long time, and there are a lot of us that have been there 30, 35 plus years. And this is the first time that we've had an issue like this. It looks like an airplane hangar. That's all that I can say. It just is so tall that it just sticks out like a sore thumb. I just oppose it. I've had realtors to come and look. I've had a landscaper. I've had a contractor to all come and give me opinions. I quoted those in the letter that you had. And I just oppose it. I'm just, it's just couple subdivisions that are within the city, and then I went and looked in the county. And not one time did I see anything that large at any homes in the country, out 84, it's out of town, and I can name all of the subdivisions that we had in the city. So it's not something that you see. You just don't see one that big. So I do oppose it. And if I can answer questions about the pictures or anything, I'd be happy to.
Any questions, any discussions?
I have some questions.
Yes, ma'am.
So you understand that if we deny the variance,
yes,
that he can take that structure down, move it 10 feet to the
south,
and put it back, and you'll still be looking at it.
But it won't be as high.
It'll be just the same. He can pick it up and move it 10 feet to the south. It'll still be there.
The point is, he meets all the regulations to have that building as it is, except being within 10 feet of the north property line.
All right.
The concrete slab is not in play other than the fact that it's holding the building. If he takes the entire building down, the concrete slab is in total compliance.
All right. As it stands, the way that its height has increased 3 feet. Last week during the hurricane, that water came under my fence and just came straight down through my garden and ran into my yard.
The height didn't have anything to do with that, Ms. Young, because...
No, I'm talking about the height of the concrete.
I understand. He had concrete here. He has concrete here. You've got the same amount of area, and it's all going to go somewhere.
Right. It wasn't as bad when it was not up the 3 feet. It seems like I'm getting more water now.
Okay, so I want to clarify. You understand that the concrete slab is going to stay there
regardless.
And he can move that building 10 feet to the south and put it back. Park his RV under it, and so RV probably isn't going to move. Truck's going to be parked. Just the building's going to be over to the side to the other.
It's 15 feet tall.
But it meets code. This board
is saying was that the code is not 15 feet high, but it is 13 and a half.
No, the code says the building cannot be taller than the highest point on his roof line.
Right, if you look at it, it's about that much higher without us going over and physically measuring.
Yeah, and you're at a disadvantage because you are on a down slope, and when you back up and look at it, it's an optical illusion to some degree that the building is higher than his house, but if you go out into the front yard and shoot a level, at least basically what we've seen by the measurements, it is not taller than the roof line.
From his front, you're looking at? We were looking at the unit itself, the cover, and then looking at the highest point, which is on the back of his garage. On the property.
If you can visualize a huge level, and you put one end on the peak of his roof and the other end on the peak of this building, uh-huh. As long as it is not higher with that level, then he has met the regulations.
And did anyone measure or look at it?
From what we understand, it is several inches below the roof line. It is not as much as a foot below the roof line. Am I not correct?
I had a contractor to tell me that if we went over and measured, that it would be taller, and you can see it. That's all that I know on that. property value for my home has dropped dramatically, and that's from two realtors. One of the realtors is on the board of the Wood Valley Homeowners Association, and the other realtor is a realtor that we have known and used for a long time. And we worked awfully hard to keep our property up, to do major improvements, to keep it at the high level so that it would sell. And I just have a major problem with that.
I understand. But please also, and everybody in here, please understand that there are limits to what this board can do, even if we deny. Like I said earlier, he can bring it into compliance, and you would still have a smaller version of it, narrower version. It's still going to be as tall. And he can do that without asking anybody's permission, and that would be, I mean, there's nothing that anybody can do to prevent that.
I hope that Mr. Collin, maybe knowing the feelings of the Wood Valley Homeowners Association, might try to work with us so that the building is not as high.
That is beyond the scope of what we can tell him to do.
I do have a question. So your issue is not the setback, it's the height of the structure?
Correct.
Okay.
Yes, sir.
Hang on, wait. Yes, sir.
My name is David Scott. I live at 2605 North Sherwood. I live one lot south of Don. And the lot in question is catty-cornered or not. From our perspective, we don't just see the back of it, we see the side of it, and it's just a big slab of tin. And I had a question for you. Was a building permit required to construct this?
Mr. Connor should have gotten a building permit.
Did he get one?
Apparently not, but at the same time, he had an existing structure and he did it himself. Had he hired a contractor to do it, contractor would have said, we need to go get a building permit. So, yes, something fell through the cracks, but at the same time, this is something that we see on a regular basis here, because not being a contractor, they are not aware of some of the rules that a contractor would say, hey, we got to talk to the city, we got to tell them what we're doing and get a permit.
Well, I can only tell you that in my case, first of all, we RV'd for many years, but in a Volkswagen bus rather than a giant unit like this. If I had purchased a huge RV like this, I would have planned on storing it somewhere other than my house. I understand he doesn't have to do that, but in any case, I think that I would have done this. But also, it seems wrong to me that someone, I mean, had I been intending to build a unit like that, I would have figured it's probably pretty questionable, and I certainly would have discovered whether I needed a building permit for it and what the rules were on what it would be. And I think it's wrong to go ahead and build it, especially a giant structure like that, and then after the fact say, well, I really didn't know it was there. I didn't know I had to do that.
I understand the premise that some people say, you know, it's easier to ask forgiveness than to ask for permission. And I'm not sitting in judgment saying it was one way or the other. What we have is the situation that we have, and we're trying to resolve it, if at all possible.
Right, I understand that. But I do believe the fact that he did not get a building permit should be considered in your decision. I mean, that's the law, isn't it?
It is the rules that normally are applied. Was there something done wrong? Yes. Do we take it into consideration? This board is aware that this has happened.
One last thing. this went up so fast. I came home one day, parked the car, heard some banging, looked over, and I thought, oh my gosh, I had no idea this was going to happen. That's all I had to say.
I have a question. I have the same question as I had for Matt. You understand that he can move it 10 feet, and you'll still be looking at that ugly side?
I understand.
Okay.
I mean, I didn't know that. I mean, I figured this thing is so unsightly that there's no way it can be allowed. It is so bad, it's unbelievable.
From
our house.
I understand. And like I said, and Ms. Porterman, he meets, first off, there's no regulations on the slab. He can put any size slab, he can pave the entire backyard if he wanted to. There's nothing to stop him from doing it. He can build it right up to the property. The height of the building, as long as it is not an upslope to the west from his peak on his roof to that building, as long as it's flat or sloping down even ever so slightly, it is according to code. He can modify that building to move northern wall 10 feet.
I understand.
Or he can pour some more concrete and pick the whole thing up, screw it over 10 feet, put it right back down.
No, I understand.
Okay.
I can only say that I never would have done this completely. That's it.
Understand. Yes, sir.
I have a question. So you're only really in opposition of the height of the structure?
I mean, I understand I can't do anything about that, which comes as a surprise to me. But, the height, it's much higher than our house, and it's very unsightly. And I agree with Ms. Young that it almost certainly decreased the value of our homes. And I know that isn't your province, and that's fine. But I think it needs to be considered.
Well, and the other thing, when the zoning rules and regulations are put into effect, they try to be as fair as they can to everybody.
I know.
At the same time, Ms. Young and you and some of the others are at a big disadvantage in that Wood Valley is a huge slope. If that was an entire flat field out there, it would not be near as noticeable because you would be on par with it instead of looking at it.
Right.
And I understand that. You know, it is what it is. You are where you are.
It's very exciting.
Is there anyone else? Yes, sir.
Forrest, you did 2115. I feel that, I just have a statement, not a question. I feel that this was put up unpermitted, there should be a penalty, and I think that in your consideration, you should make him move that 10 feet. Thank you.
Yes, sir. And just correct me if I'm not wrong, he will have to buy a permit after the fact, and there is a penalty financially, isn't there?
He is in court now.
I
actually he's going to be code enforcement is working with him to rectify the situation. I do not know if Judge Bender, if it goes through the court system, I don't know what fines Judge Bender might impose.
Well, there is a possibility.
Yeah.
Quickly, Rain, is there anyone else would like to speak in opposition, or have we got the information? Raymond, quickly, keep raising your hand, quickly.
Couple of things. Number one, the reason for the height of the slab has nothing to do with wanting to build the thing up. In order to build that cover, the builder or the guy I bought it from says you've got 2 inches of height variance to play with from the base support beams. In other words, if the thing ain't level more than 2 inches off, it can't be a structure. So you say that's the reason for the height of it, based on the slope of the land. Yeah, it's level. and I realize it's level starting up at the southern end of it going north. And that everything gets, the slope is extreme on the northwest corner, so that's the reason the slab is higher. All I can say is, in addition, like I said, I'm more than willing to build buffers as far as to create a buffer between, if there's a height issue. No, I ain't gonna be putting 20, 40 foot cedars up there, but they're, even the, like I said, the article says, they'll be within 3 years, they'll be at 15 to 20 foot.
Thanks. I got a question for you.
Yes, sir.
How long have you owned the RV?
Since May.
How long?
May.
Since May, okay. Where did you park it before you constructed it?
I didn't actually physically pick it up till the end of June.
Okay.
So for about a month, I parked it off-site. A few times before it was ready, I have to park it on the street, which also causes a problem. Streets out there are very narrow, and my neighbors can tell you there ain't a whole lot of room when you park something on the street like that. And if we go on a trip, it's a 2 or 3 day load up. You can get everything in and thing ready to go.
Is this the first RV or living that you, a mobile trailer that you have had since you lived there?
That I own, yes. I borrowed one, and that was like pop-up camper day.
Okay.
But we're talking much smaller and all that sort of stuff. This is something we plan on going across the country. So we got to have something we can survive in.
Okay. Thank you, Reed.
All right.
Okay. Any other questions? Any other discussions?
I have one more. I apologize if I tear your name up, but Dr.
It's Gamow. It's French. A French name. Yeah.
I apologize.
That's fine. Just call me George, please.
How many residents are members of the HOA now?
Hang on, and I'll get those data for you.